The Secret Garden. It's a title that holds all sorts of rather forbidden-sounding promises. But to people of my generation, not to mention the generation before and the generation before that, it's more especially a title that brings back memories of happy childhood hours with a good book. Because Frances Hodgson Burnett's little novel has become a much-loved classic of its kind. Mrs. Burnett's the sort of author you'd have thought was distinctly not for the 1990s, the age of the Supermen and Spider-Men and Super Mario Bros.'s of the new and very different worlds of popular fiction. Her sentimental tales of turn-of-the-century England with their Pollyanna-ish heroes and heroines ought to have had their day. But somehow, they haven't. Against all seeming logic, The Secret Garden and Little Lord Fauntleroy are still going as strongly today as ever. Why? Probably because it's not children who keep popular children's fiction alive from one generation to the next. It's parents. It's we who buy the books that we think our children will like, or ought to like. And I don't know about you, but Transformers and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles are a bit outside my terms of reference. Whereas The Secret Garden's a pretty memory from a childhood when the world was a nicer place, and the once-upon-a-time England it was set in seemed an even nicer place. It's also, of course, the grown-up generation who make films and television series, who write and produce plays and musicals, and who buy videos, recordings, and tickets for the plays and musicals. All this, of course, means it's we who are responsible for the Burnett mini-boom of recent years, and it's we who, deny it though we might prefer, wallow so happily through this author's super-sentimental little sagas all the way up to their cloudlessly happy endings. And if the kids can be persuaded to turn off the turtles for a moment and join us in our bit of old-time sweetness and light, then so much the better. The Burnett mini-boom is, needless to say, mini. I'm not talking about something on the scale of Star Wars or Indiana Jones. We're in an altogether more modest area. But for a very middle-ranking 150-year-old novelist come playwright, Fanny Burnett, with a little help from her friends, has been remarkably visible over the last decade or so. The 1980s brought, just as an example, new British television versions of both her favourite works, and their old large-screen ones got a fresh TV showing as well. My world at that time was the world of the London theatre, specifically the musical theatre. And during those years, over my desk came hosts of hopeful musical scripts and scores that were looking for a West End or a Broadway production. Many of them followed a fashion. Firstly, there were stage Cockney musicals written in the hope that Tommy Steele would star in them. Then, in the wake of Jesus Christ Superstar, a wash of sung-through musicals on biblical subjects. And after Evita, a particularly painful parade of biographical musicals from Queen Victoria to Garibaldi. But while these trends came and went, there was always a steady trickle of scripts based on the classics of English language literature. And Mrs. Burnett was truly disproportionately represented. I can remember at least three Little Lord Fauntleroys. And in the 1980s, after the author's copyright ran out, there was scarcely a year when A Secret Garden didn't put in an appearance. One of these actually got a showing in the professional theatre. The Playhouse in Salisbury, where the cathedral comes from, produced a version that had been written and composed by a group of three ladies. Now, one of these ladies happened to be the sister of a well-known British actor, and afterwards, he sent their script and score on to some West End producers. And so, it arrived on my desk. I thought it was charming, but I didn't think it was large-scale London material, and so I passed it on. But it didn't disappear. Quite a few years later, an American producer called Lou Hager, whom I'd worked with earlier on a musical version of that sweet old play Peg of My Heart, brought me a script that had caught his fancy. It was The Secret Garden. It was still charming, and still, I thought, quite unsuitable for a big West End or Broadway stage. Then a second musical version of the tale hit the stage, and this one was produced not in the provinces, but in London. Not at the Palladium or Drury Lane, though. It was mounted on the postage-stamp-sized stage at Dan Crawford's King's Head Theatre Club. Like Secret Garden Mark I, Secret Garden Mark II did nicely enough. It played its limited season, and then it was put away. Now, I thought, this little burst of Secret Gardens had surely to be over. But it wasn't. The Secret Garden was eventually to get its large-scale production. on Broadway. I don't know quite what happened between Lou's visit to my office and the arrival of the Secret Garden in New York, but the show that opened there, with his group's name amongst its producers, in 1991, wasn't the one that had been played at Salisbury. The names of the three British ladies were nowhere to be seen. Instead, there was a whole new group of ladies, American ones this time, featured. As writers, director, choreographer, costume designer, scenic designer, lighting designer, as well as a leading lady, even though the novel didn't have one. This wasn't the Secret Garden Mark 1A at all. It was a completely new Secret Garden, Mark 3, the American version, the big version. Tonight, we're going to play you much of the score that was composed by Lucy Simon, to words by Marsha Norman, to illustrate this Broadway stage version of Mrs. Burnett's tale. And in between the numbers, Kate Harcourt will read some excerpts from the original novel to help you follow the story and set the context for the songs. It's a combination that'll provide you with some unusual contrasts, for the composer and lyricist haven't just chosen to accompany their pretty Edwardian story with a simple score of pretty Edwardian pastiche melodies. They've gone instead for a very eclectic musical style, part classic and part modern. There are lyrical soprano lines for the show's leading lady, the ghostly Lily. These are sung by Phantom of the Opera star Rebecca Luca, in one of the loveliest voices to be heard on Broadway in years. There are romantic arias and duos for sad and somber Uncle Archibald, played here by Mandy Patinkin, as deeply tortured Uncle Archibald, haunted by the shadowy presence of his lost wife. There are spunky soubrette songs for the classic chirpy maid of musical comedy and bright, determinedly Yorkshire ones for the Yorkshire gardener's lad. There are some kiddie pieces for the 11-year-olds of the piece, and less predictably, there are even some moments of 1970s Pippin-style music, as well as one very incidental piece that sounds to me rather like a hoedown. Since we couldn't play quite the whole of the show's very considerable score, I'm afraid I've jibbed at the hoedown. I might, of course, be being quite unfair here. I mean, maybe the hoedown is an ancient Yorkshire folk dance, and I just didn't know it. But anyhow, we shouldn't worry too much if just occasionally the musical part of this Secret Garden is a touch more Broadway than Yorkshire or turn of the century. That's the way the theatre goes, especially the musical theatre. Let's just sit back and enjoy an hour or so of a sweet mixture of 1909 words from the original and 1991 songs from the most recent version of The Secret Garden.
When Mary Lennox was sent to Misselthwaite Manor to live with her uncle, everybody said she was the most disagreeable-looking child ever seen. It was true, too. She had a little thin face and a little thin body, thin light hair and a sour expression. Her hair was yellow and her face was yellow because she'd been born in India and had always been ill in one way or another. Her father had held a position under the English government and had always been busy and ill himself. And her mother had been a great beauty, who cared only to go to parties and amuse herself with gay people. She'd not wanted a little girl at all, and when Mary was born, she handed her over to the care of an ayah. The child never remembered seeing familiarly anything but the dark faces of her ayah and the other native servants, and as they always obeyed her and gave her her own way in everything, because the Memsahib would be angry if she was disturbed by her crying. By the time she was 6 years old, she was as tyrannical and selfish a little pig as ever lived.
Mrs. Mary.
But Mary's life was suddenly changed. The cholera hit Bangkok. Both her parents died in the epidemic, and the little girl, abandoned by her native servants, was discovered one morning in her family's bungalow, the only person still alive.
Can it be a dream? Surely it must seem like a frightful dream. How can this be true?
Won't her mother come? Come, wake her up to play. Won't her father say, here's a rose for you?
There's a girl who no one sees. There's a girl who's left alone. There's a heart that beats in silence for the life she's never known. For the life she's never known.
And so Mary Lennox was sent back to England, to her widowed uncle, Archibald Craven, of Misselthwaite Manor.
I suppose you might as well be told something to prepare you. You're going to a queer place. Mary said nothing at all, and Mrs. Medlock looked rather discomforted by her apparent indifference. But after taking a breath, she went on. Not but that it's a grand big place in a gloomy way. Mr. Craven's proud of it in his way, and that's gloomy enough too. The house is 600 years old, and it's on the edge of the moor, and there's near 100 rooms in it, though most of them shut and locked, and there's pictures and fine old furniture and things that's been there for ages, and there's a big park round it, and gardens and trees with branches trailing to the ground, some of them. But there's nothing else.
High on the hills is a big old house with something wrong inside it. Spirits walk the halls and linger ever now to hide it. What will put their souls to rest and stop their ceaseless sighing? Why do they call out children's names and speak of one who's crying?
Well, said Mrs. Medlock, what do you think of it? Nothing, Mary answered. I know nothing about such places. That made Mrs. Medlock laugh, a short sort of laugh. Eh, she said, picture like an old woman, don't you care? It doesn't matter, said Mary, whether I care or not. You're right enough there, said Mrs. Medlock. It doesn't. What you're to be kept at Misselthwaite Manor for, I don't know, unless it's the easiest way. He's not going to trouble himself about you, that's sure and certain. He never troubles about no one. She stopped herself, as if she just remembered something in time. He's got a crooked back, she said. That set him all wrong. He was a sour young man and got no good of all his money and big place until he was married. She was a sweet, pretty thing, and he'd have walked the world over to get her a blade of grass she wanted. Nobody thought she'd marry him, but she did. And people said she married him for his money, but she didn't, she didn't. When she died, it made him queerer than ever. He cares about nobody. He won't see people. Most of the time he goes away, and when he's at Misselthwaite, he shuts himself up in the West Wing.
And the master hears the whispers on the stairways, dark and still. And the spirits speak of secrets in the house upon the hill.
It sounded like something in a book, and it did not make Mary feel cheerful. A house with 100 rooms, nearly all shut up and with their doors locked. A house on the edge of a moor, whatsoever a moor was, sounded dreary. A man with a crooked back who shut himself up also.
High on the hills, it's a big old house with something wrong inside it. Someone died and someone's left alone and can't abide it. There in the house is a lonely man still haunted by her beauty, asking for the life that we will not remain of duty.
They drove into a clear space and stopped before an immensely long but low-built house, which seemed to ramble around a stone court. At first Mary thought there were no lights at all in the windows. But as she got out of the carriage, she saw that one window, in a corner upstairs, showed a dull glow. A neat, thin old man stood near the manservant who opened the door for them. "You are to take her to her room," he said in a husky voice. He doesn't want to see her. And then Mary Lennox was led up a broad staircase and down a long corridor and up a short flight of steps and through another corridor and another until a door opened in a wall and she found herself in a room with a fire in it and a supper on a table. Mrs. Medlock said unceremoniously, "Well, here you are. This room and the next are where you live, and you must keep to them. Don't you forget that." It was in this way Mistress Mary arrived at Misselthwaite Manor, and she had perhaps never felt so contrary in all her life. She looked at the fire and listened to the wind wuthering. It seemed to be wuthering louder than ever. But as she was listening to the wind, she began to listen to something else. She did not know what it was, because at first she could scarcely distinguish it from the wind itself. It was a curious sound. It seemed almost as if a child were crying somewhere. When she opened her eyes in the morning, it was because a young housemaid had come into her room to light the fire and was kneeling on the hearthrug, raking out the cinders noisily.
Mary quickly found that Martha wasn't going to wait on her hand and foot like a Bombay ayah, and that she had no sympathy with the sullen child's fine and finicky ways.
"You wrap up warm and run out and play, you," said Martha. "It'll do you good and give you some stomach for your meat." Mary went to the window. There were gardens and paths and big trees, but everything looked dull and wintry. "Out? Why should I go out on a day like this?" "Well, if tha doesn't go, tha'll have to stay in, and what has tha got to do?" Mary glanced about her. There was nothing to do. When Mrs. Medlock had prepared the nursery, she'd not thought of amusement. Perhaps it would be better to go and see what the gardens were like. "Who will go with me?" she inquired. Martha stared. "You'll go by yourself," she answered. "You'll have to learn to play like other children does when they haven't got sisters and brothers."
"If I had a fine white horse, I'd take you for a ride today. But since I have no fine white horse inside, I'll have to stay and empty all the chamber pots and scrub the floors and such. But what's there to do on a fine white horse? It seems to me not much. If I had a wooden boat, I'd take you for a sail today. But since I have no wooden boat inside, I'll have to stay and catch and kill the mice and cluck the chickens for the cook. But what's there to do on a wooden boat? But sit up straight and look and worry our boat will start to drift and float us out to sea and land us on an isle of gold. Oh dear, oh dearie me. If I had a chambermaid, I'd take you out to play today. They say that there's a maze where once you enter, there you stay. For certain we'd get lost and they'd come looking for our bones and find us sometime late next week and bring us tea and scones. But what if there's a clan of trolls a-camping neath a tree? Oh, what if there's a pirate cave? Oh dear, oh dear. Oh dear. I'd take you out the door today. But talking birds and tales of fairies keep me scared away. And yes, I promised not to tell what else is there, although if in the maze you chance to see a garden guarded by a tree and meet a bird who speaks to me, then come and tell my fine white horse and me. Can you find stairs, past the ballroom, through the hall.
I'll find it.
Martha found her coat and hat for her, and a pair of stout little boots, and she showed her the way downstairs. If tha goes round that way, they'll come to the gardens. She seemed to hesitate a second before she added, "One of the gardens is locked up. No one's been in it for years." "Why?" asked Mary, in spite of herself. Here was another locked door that added to the hundred in the strange house. "Mr. Craven had it shut when his wife died so sudden. He won't let no one go inside. It was her garden." "But why did he hate it so?" "It was Mrs. Craven's garden that she'd made when they were first married, and she just loved it. And they used to tend the flowers themselves, and none of the gardeners was ever let to go in. Him and her used to go and shut the door and stay there hours and hours reading and talking."
Oatcakes and cream, sweet plums in a jar.
And every day to my garden, this man, who might he be, came bearing baskets of roses, for he loved me.
All I own I'd give,
just a garden.
All I would ask is never to,
never to leave.
Say you'll have me, say you will keep me. Where you would lead me, there I would, there I would, there I would, there I would go.
Man who came to my
garden,
was just a bit of a girl, and there was an old tree with a branch bent like a seat on it, and she made roses grow over it, and she used to sit there. But one day when she was sitting there, the branch broke, and she fell on the ground and was hurt so bad that next day she died. The doctors thought he'd go out of his mind and die too. That's why he hates it. No one's ever gone in there since, and he won't let anyone talk about it. Mary did not ask any more questions.
Springtime came, and as the first flowers began to open, Mary Lennox, at first cautiously and unsurely, began to open up as well. To her surprise, she found things to like, and began to feel that for the first time in her life, she was liked herself. First she made friends with a robin, and then with a boy.
There was a laurel-hedged walk which curved round the secret garden and ended at a gate which opened into a wood in the park. She thought she'd skip round this walk and look into the wood and see if there were any rabbits hopping about. She enjoyed the skipping very much, and when she reached the little gate, she opened it and went through because she heard a low, peculiar whistling sound and wanted to find out what it was. It was a very strange thing indeed. She quite caught her breath. A boy was sitting under a tree with his back against it, playing on a rough wooden pipe. He was a funny-looking boy, about 12. He looked very clean, and his nose turned up, and his cheeks were as red as poppies, and never had Mistress Mary seen such round and such blue eyes in any boy's face. And on the trunk of the tree he leaned against, a brown squirrel was clinging and watching him, and from behind a bush nearby a cock pheasant was delicately stretching his neck to peep out, and quite near to him were two rabbits sitting up and sniffing with tremulous noses. And it actually appeared as if they were all drawing near to watch and listen.
Winter's on the wing, here's a fine spring morn. Coming clean through the night, come on, may I say. Winter's taking flight, sweeping dark cold air out to sea. Spring is born, comes the day, I say, and you'll be here to see it. Stand and breathe it all the day. Stop and feel it. Stop and hear it. Spring, I say. And now the sun is climbing high, rising fast on fire, flaring down through the gloom, gone the grey I see. The sun spells the doom of the winter's rain. Ice and chill must retire, come the May I see. And you'll be here to see it. Stand and breathe it all our days. Stop and feel it. Stop and hear it. Spring. I say, be gone, ye howling gales, be off, ye frosty morns, all ye solid streams begin to fall. Melt ye waterfalls, heart ye frozen winter walls. See, see now it's starting, and now the mist is lifting high, leaving bright blue air rolling clear across the moor. Come the May, I say, the storm will soon be by, leaving clear blue sky. Soon the sun will shine, come the day, say hi, and you'll be here to see it. Go stand and breathe it all the day. Stop and feel it. Stop and hear it.
I'm Dickon, the boy said. He did not speak to her as if they'd never seen each other before, but as if he knew her quite well. Mary knew nothing about boys, and she spoke to him a little stiffly because she felt rather shy. She wished she could talk as he did. His speech was so quick and easy.
I'm a girl.
She is a lass. As took a greatly fancy to thee. Dost thou fear?
Thou mun not fear.
She's took thee on for lack to vex thee. Now to the sort.
Now to the sort.
She knows farewell, she mun not fret thee.
Canna thou show me?
Fare better to know her.
Show me the key.
Show her the key. She's a lass, and now her fright is needs a spot where she can rest in.
I mun sit where I'll not be so thinking thoughts or feel a guest in.
Now to the sort.
Now to the sort.
She'd fair be watching for the spring.
I'll not be climbing up, I'll only be calling good morning, and fellow I'll sing.
Done, Mary!
I'll only walk around as like to see it for myself. If thou canst allow me visit, I'll speak low into thyself. Thou'll not be bothered night and day by wenches racing round. I'll but seem a silent dream, standing on the secret ground. I'd but smell the growing things, count the roses gainst the wall. Hear thy babes when first they peck, stretch my hands if they should fall. Or if thou likes, I'll bring thee seeds of worms all in a mound. For if thou'll have me for a friend, Thou be the first I found. I'm a lass,
not just a lass,
that took a greatly fancy to thee. Can ever show me,
well, dost thou know her?
Show me the key.
The robin Mary had befriended, the cheery little fellow who made his home in the tree she could see beyond the wall of the secret garden, had led her to the garden's key. The key that had been lost for the 10 years since Archibald Craven had closed the garden door forever. Perhaps, some day, she thought, she would find the door that had fitted. Then, quite out of the blue, one day Mr. Craven sent for her.
"I forgot you," he said. "How could I remember you? I intended to send you a governess or a nurse or something of the sort, but I forgot." "Please," began Mary, "please." And then the lump in her throat choked her. "What do you want to say?" he inquired. I'm too big for a nurse," said Mary, "and please, please don't make me have a governess yet." Her anxious little face seemed to worry him more than ever. "Don't look so frightened," he exclaimed. "Is there anything you want?" As if a sudden thought had struck him. "Do you want toys, books, dolls?" "Might I," quavered Mary, "might I have a bit of earth?" In her eagerness, she did not realize how queer the words would sound, and that they were not the ones she'd meant to say. Mr. Craven looked startled. "Earth?" he repeated. "What do you mean? To plant seeds and to make things grow, to see them come alive?" He gazed at her a moment, and then passed his hand quickly over his eyes.
"Ill and tired, and it was too hot. I sometimes played at
She wants a little
beds,
bit of her.
Sticking things in the
She'll
sand.
Plant some seeds. The seeds will grow. The flowers bloom. But is their bounty what she needs? How can she chance to love a little bit of earth? Does she not know? The earth is old and doesn't care if one small girl wants things to grow. She needs a friend. She needs a father, brother, sister, mother's arms. She needs to laugh. She needs to dance and learn to work her girlish charms. She needs a home. The only thing she really needs I cannot give. Instead she asks a bit of earth to make it live. She should have a pony gallop across the moor. She should have a doll's house with 100 rooms per floor. Something that money can buy that won't die. When I give her the world, she asks instead for some earth. A bit of her. She wants a little bit of her. She'll plant some seeds. The seeds will grow. The flowers bloom. Their beauty, just the thing she needs. She'll grow to love the tender roses, lilies fair, the iris tall. And then in fall, her bit of earth will freeze and kill them all. A bit of earth, a bit of earth.
You can have as much earth as you want, he said. You remind me of someone else who loved the earth and things that grow. When you see a bit of earth you want, with something like a smile, Take it, child, and make it come alive. Mary ran to find Martha. I can have my garden, she cried. I may have it where I like. He says a little girl like me couldn't do any harm, and I may do what I like anywhere. Eh, said Martha, delighted. That was nice of him, wasn't it? Martha, said Mary solemnly, he's really a nice man, only his face is so miserable and his forehead's all drawn together.
Mary looked forward to the morning, to seeing Dickon again and to starting to make her garden.
But you never know what the weather will do in Yorkshire, particularly in the springtime. She was awakened in the night by the sound of rain beating with heavy drops against her window. It was pouring down in torrents, and the wind was wuthering round the corners and in the chimneys of the huge old house. Mary sat up in bed and felt miserable and angry. The rain is as contrary as ever I was, she said. It came because it knew I didn't want it. She threw herself back on her pillow and buried her face. It sounds just like a person lost on the moor and wandering on and crying, she said. She'd been lying awake, turning from side to side for about an hour, when suddenly something made her sit up in bed and turn her head towards the door, listening. She listened, and she listened. It isn't the wind now, she said in a loud whisper. That isn't the wind, it's different. It's that crying I heard before.
Someone is crying. Just now I heard them. Someone in this house is crying. Why won't they tell me? I know they're lying. Someone here is lost or mad. I must try to find them, beg them stop, so I can sleep. I heard someone crying. Who the could it be? Someone in this house who no one seems to see. Someone no one seems to hear except for me.
Mary got up and went, half boldly, through the dark and empty corridors in search of the sound. At last she saw a glimmer of light. She pushed open a door, gently, and found a big, rich room with a huge four-poster bed. In the bed was a boy, and he was crying.
He had a sharp, delicate face, the colour of ivory, and he seemed to have eyes too big for it. He also had a lot of hair which tumbled over his forehead in heavy locks and made his thin face seem smaller. He looked like a boy who'd been ill, but he was crying more as if he were tired and cross than as if he were in pain. Mary stood near the door with her candle in her hand, holding her breath. Then she crept across the room, and as she drew nearer, the light attracted the boy's attention, and he turned his head on his pillow and stared at her, his grey eyes opening so wide that they seemed immense. "Who are you?" he said at last in a half-frightened whisper. "Are you a ghost?" "No, I am not," Mary answered, her own whisper sounding half-frightened. "Are you one?" "No," he replied after waiting a moment or so. "I am Colin." "Who is Colin?" she faltered. "I am Colin Craven. Who are you?" "I'm Mary Lennox. Mr. Craven is my uncle." "He's my father," said the boy. "Your father? No one ever told me he had a boy. Why didn't they?" "Come here," he said, still keeping his strange eyes fixed on her with an anxious expression. She came close to the bed, and he put out his hand and touched her. "You are real, aren't you? I have such real dreams very often. You might be one of them."
Some nights I dream that a round-shouldered man comes in my room on a beam of moonlight. He never says what he wants. He just sits with a book in his hands. And then I dreamed that the round-shouldered man takes me off on a ride through the moors by moonlight. Where we'll go, we just right across the hills till dawn. And some night I'm going to ask him, is the night sky black or blue? I know the answer's in his book, although that's good and true. Once I dreamed that the round-shouldered man took my hand and we walked to a secret garden. I never knew where we were. We just sat in the crook of a broken tree. And so tonight I'm going to ask him how the old moon turns to new. I know the answer's in true. I'm sure the answer's in his book of all that's good and true.
Mrs. Medlock was horrified when she discovered that Mary had found her way to the invalid boy's room, and the girl was sent packing. With the voices of the past and the present swirling about her, she ran from the house into the garden, and before she knew it, found herself at the door of the secret garden.
Shaking the souls of the dead, breaking the blood of thorns, shaking the roof on our head. Oh, since I was a child, I believed.
Mistress Mary, quite contrary, how does your garden grow?
Oh, it's dry, she wilts, see the eyes are spilled, and it tumbled down, just so.
Mary Lennox had heard a great deal about magic in her Ayah's stories, and she always said what happened to her at that moment was magic. A nice little gust of wind rushed down the walk, and it was a stronger one than the rest. It was strong enough to wave the branches of the trees, and it was more than strong enough to sway the trailing sprays of untrimmed ivy hanging from the wall. Suddenly, the gust of wind swung aside some loose ivy trails, and more suddenly still, Mary jumped towards it and caught it in her hand. This she did because she'd seen something under it, a round knob which had been covered by the leaves hanging over it. It was the knob of a door. She put her hands under the leaves and began to pull and push them aside. Thick as the ivy hung, it nearly all was a loose and swinging curtain, though some had crept over wood and iron. Mary's heart began to thump, and her hands to shake a little in her delight and excitement. The robin kept singing and twittering away and tilting his head on one side, as if he were as excited as she was. What was this under her hands which was square and made of iron, and which her fingers found a hole in? It was the lock of the door which had been closed 10 years, and she put her hand in her pocket, drew out the key, and found it fitted the keyhole. She put the key in and turned it. It took two hands to do it, but it did turn. And then she took a long breath and looked behind her up the long walk to see if anyone was coming. No one was coming. No one ever did come, it seemed. And she took another long breath because she could not help it, and she held back the swinging curtain of ivy and pushed back the door, which opened slowly, slowly. Then she slipped through it and shut it behind her, and stood with her back against it, looking about her and breathing fast with excitement and wonder and delight. She was standing inside the secret garden.
The
secret garden became Mary's bit of earth. And when the storms had passed, she and Dickon began to tend its forgotten flowers.
On that first morning, when the sky was blue again, Mary wakened very early. The sun was pouring in slanting rays through the blinds, and there was something so joyous in the sight of it that she jumped out of bed and ran to the window. She drew up the blinds and opened the window itself, and a great waft of fresh, scented air blew in upon her. The moor was blue, and the whole world looked as if something magic had happened to it. There were tender little fluting sounds here and there and everywhere, as if scores of birds were beginning to tune up for a concert. Mary put her hand out of the window and held it in the sun. "It's warm, warm," she said. "It will make the green points push up and up and up, and it'll make the bulbs and roots work and struggle with all their might under the earth." She kneeled down and leaned out of the window as far as she could. "It must be very early," she said. "The little clouds are all pink, and I've never seen the sky look like this. No one's up. I don't even hear the stable boys." A sudden thought made her scramble to her feet. "I can't wait. I'm going to see the garden." Mary raced to the garden, only to find that Dickon was there before her. "Oh, Dickon, Dickon, how could you get here so early? How could you? The sun has only just got up." He got up himself, laughing and glowing and tousled, his eyes like a bit of the sky. "Eh," he said, "I was up long before him. How could I have stayed abed? The world's all fair begun again this morning, it has, and I come straight here. I couldn't have stayed away. Why, the garden was lying here waiting." Mary put her hands on her chest, panting as if she'd been running herself. "See here," said Dickon. "See how these is pushed up, and these and these, and here, look at these here."
For the garden was starting to revive. Sad and grey as it had looked, it was not dead. Beneath the brown tangle of 10 years, it was what the Yorkshire folk called wick. It had life in it.
"When a thing is wick, it has a life about it. Now maybe not a life like you and me, but somewhere there's a single streak of green inside it. Come and let me show you what I mean. When a thing is wick, it has a light around it. Maybe not a light that you can see, but hiding down below, sparks asleep inside it, waiting for the right time to be seen. You clear away the dead parts so the tender buds can fall. Loosen up the earth and let the roots get warm. Let the roots get warm. Oh,
each day like you and me. Will it grow?
It will.
Then have no doubt about it, we'll have the grandest garden ever seen."
Whilst Mary and Dickon watched the robin build its nest, and the little girl blossomed along with her garden, she did not forget Colin. Mr. Craven had left Misselthwaite and its too many memories for a long trip to Europe, and Mary was able to steal to the nerve-racked, bedridden boy's side every day, encouraging him to believe that he was neither fated to become a hunchback like his father, nor doomed to an early death, as his doctors had predicted. If he really wanted to, he could leave his room. He could leave the house and see the secret garden, his mother's garden, for himself. And so, at last, Colin left his bed and the house for the first time, and he was wheeled in his chair through all the pretty paths and places that Mary had described to him until they reached the secret garden. Dickon opened the door.
Colin actually dropped back against his cushions, even though he gasped with delight, and he covered his eyes with his hands until they were inside and the chair stopped as if by magic, and the door was closed. Not till then did he take them away and look round and round and round as Dickon and Mary had done, and over walls and earth and trees and swinging sprays and tendrils the fair green veil of tender little leaves had crept, and in the grass under the trees and the grey urns and the alcoves and here and there and everywhere were splashes of gold and purple and white, and the trees were showing pink and snow above his head, and there were fluttering of wings and faint sweet pipes and humming and scents and scents. And the sun fell warm upon his face with a lovely touch. And in wonder, Mary and Dickon stood and stared at him. He looked so strange and different, because a pink glow of colour had actually crept all over him, ivory face and neck and hands and all. "I shall get well, I shall get well," he cried out. "Mary, Dickon, I shall get well, and I shall live for ever and ever and ever." And delight reigned. They drew the chair under the plum tree, which was snow-white with blossoms and musical with bees. Mary and Dickon worked a little here and there, and Colin watched them. "Us'll have thee walking about here and digging same as other folk afore long," said Dickon. Colin flushed tremendously. "Walk," he said. "Dig? Shall I?"
Then it happened.
There was a brief, fierce scramble. The rugs were tossed onto the ground. Dickon held Colin's arm. The thin legs were out. The thin feet were on the grass. Colin was standing upright, upright as straight as an arrow and looking strangely tall, his head thrown back and his strange eyes flashing. Secret Garden was coming alive, and two children were coming alive with it. There was a man wandering about certain faraway, beautiful places, in the Norwegian fjords, the valleys and mountains of Switzerland. And he was a man who for 10 years had kept his mind filled with dark and heartbroken thinking. He had not been courageous. He'd never tried to put any other thoughts in place of the dark ones. A terrible sorrow had fallen upon him when he'd been happy, and he'd let his soul fill itself with blackness and had refused obstinately to let any rift of light pierce through. He'd forgotten and deserted his home and duties. When he travelled about, darkness so brooded over him that most strangers thought he must be either half mad or a man with some hidden crime on his soul.
And while he was in the depth of his blackest thoughts, a letter from Mary Lennox reached him. Then, finally, far from home, Archibald Craven began to face up to the blackness that poisoned his existence. The ghostly memory of the lovely wife he had never dared hope he would win, and whom, having won, he had so tragically lost.
Everybody else is too. Please come home.
Home. I have no home.
Martha says that you're in Paris.
It's a house, child.
Very far away.
Just a house.
Do they have nice girls and boys?
I can't get far enough away from it.
Please come home.
Now just sign it.
Should I say that Colin's well known?
Streets of Paris like a maze.
Should I say that Dr. Craven?
Sleepless nights and aimless days.
I think that what you have is good. Let's get it posted on its way. He'll rush home and you can tell him all the rest you have to say.
Oh, kind sir, Uncle Archie, I wish that you could see when you come into the garden. Please come home
for me.
Yours truly. Well, maybe.
about your friend Mary.
Oh, I see you in the window of a carriage, then a train. Still my mind will not accept that in your grave you must remain. I hear your voice, then turn and see a stranger's form and face. Must I wander untormented place to place to place to place? Where can I go that you won't find me? Why can't I find a place to hide? Why do you want to chase me, haunt me every step you're there? Beside me, where in the world, tell me where in the world can I live? Without your love, where on the earth, tell me, where on the earth can I stay now that you are gone? Why did I have to meet you, love you? Why can I rid you from my mind? Why did you have to want me? Won't you let me put my life behind me? How in the world, tell me, how in the world can I live without your love? Why on the earth, tell me, why on the earth should I stay now that you are gone? Now that you are...
Lily, is that you?
Oh,
Then Archibald Craven decided to go home.
In a few days, he was in Yorkshire again, and on his long railroad journey he found himself thinking of his boy as he'd never thought in all the 10 years past. During those years, he'd only wished to forget him. He remembered the black days when he'd raved like a madman because the child was alive and the mother was dead. The first time he returned to Misselthwaite and the small, miserable-looking thing languidly and indifferently lifted to his face the great grey eyes, with black lashes round them, so like and yet so horribly unlike the happy eyes he had adored, he could not bear the sight of them and turned away, pale as death. After that, he scarcely ever saw him except when he was asleep. And all he knew of him was that he was a confirmed invalid with a vicious, hysterical, half-insane temper.
But when he reached home and asked after his son, he was amazed to be told that Colin was in the garden. With a strange feeling of being drawn back to the place he'd so long forsaken, he made his way towards the secret garden.
As he drew near to it, his step became still more slow. He knew where the door was, even though the ivy hung over it, but he did not know exactly where it lay, that buried key. So he stopped and stood still, looking about him, and almost the moment after he'd paused, he started and listened, asking himself if he were walking in a dream. The ivy hung thick over the door. The key was buried under the shrubs. No human being had passed that portal for 10 lonely years. And yet inside the garden there were sounds. They were sounds of running, scuffling feet seeming to chase round and round under the trees. They were strange sounds of lowered, suppressed voices, exclamations and smothered, joyous cries. It seemed actually like the laughter of young things, the uncontrollable laughter of children who were trying not to be heard, but who in a moment or so, as their excitement mounted, would burst forth. What in heaven's name was he dreaming of? What in heaven's name did he hear? And then the moment came, the uncontrollable moment when the sounds forgot to hush themselves. The feet ran faster and faster. They were nearing the garden door. There was quick, strong, young breathing and a wild outbreak of laughing shouts which could not be contained. And the door in the wall was flung wide open, the sheet of ivy swinging back, and a boy burst through it at full speed and, without seeing the outsider, dashed almost into his arms. He was a tall boy and a handsome one. He was glowing with life, and his running had sent splendid colour leaping to his face. He threw the thick hair back from his forehead and lifted a pair of strange grey eyes, eyes full of boyish laughter and rimmed with black lashes like a fringe. It was the eyes which made Mr. Craven gasp for breath. "Father," he said, "I'm Colin." Mr. Craven put his hands on both the boy's shoulders and held him still. He knew he dared not even try to speak for a moment. "Take me into the garden, my boy," he said at last, "and tell me all about it."